singing to reflect on the work of Christ. Well, by God's grace, we are continuing our time in 1 Peter 3, one verse this morning, verse 7. We have been spending time thinking about authority and submission structures that Jesus gifts to the world, and we've been spending time thinking about the home. Last time we looked at wives, and today, husbands. I'm going to read, beginning up in verse 1, what we looked at last week, down to verse 7, so we have that larger context. Pray, and then we'll jump right into the message this morning. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands. As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are her children, if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. Well, this is God's word. Let's look to him together in prayer. Father, we thank you that you have not left us in darkness. We thank you that ultimately you have brought us from death to life through Jesus Christ. His sinless life, his substitutionary death for our sins, his resurrection from the grave, his ascension into heaven, his outpouring of the Spirit, you have brought us from death to life and darkness to light. Lord, we pray this morning that you would grant repentance where repentance is needed, that you would save those who don't know you. But Lord, we thank you that in the gift of salvation, you have also given us the gift of your word. You have not left us to blindly navigate this world, but your word is, it's that operation manual. It's the owner's manual in the glove compartment of our lives. It shows us what you want of us in everything, and in this case, in marriages, and specifically, husbands. So Lord, we pray that you would pour out grace this morning. Give conviction where conviction is needed. Give encouragement where there is a downtroddenness. Give hope where there is hopelessness. Give direction where there's aimlessness. Give everything that we need, Lord, so that marriages in this room would be shaped by the gospel and reflect it. Future marriages in this room would be prepared to do the same. And Lord, for all of it, that you would get glory and that we would see Jesus. So Lord, would you let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. And all of God's people said, amen. As a husband, he would use his voice, he would use his stature, he would use his attitude to push his wife down, to control her, even causing her to fear him, not knowing what he would do. But there's another husband. There's another husband. He spoke gently with his wife. He spoke gently with her. He listened to her. He was playful with her. He made her feel loved, heard, and safe. There was another marriage. The husband worked long hours. He brought home a big paycheck, provided a nice big home, all the toys, all the clothes, all the amenities, all the vacations. But he was disengaged in the relationship. He wanted to go off when he got home and tinker in the garage, putter around the house. He wanted to do his own thing. She kept nagging him. What more could she want, he said. He's given her everything. The thing is, he didn't give her himself. Or there's another husband. He declined a promotion at work, eventually choosing to downsize their home and their lifestyle. Why did he do this? Because their bigger home and bigger lifestyle and the bigger paycheck was keeping him away from his wife far too much. They wanted kids, but the cost of living was making it really difficult for them to even consider having children, but not anymore. He led the family in sacrificing worldly goods for a stronger marriage, a stable home life, and Lord willing, children. One husband is an angry shouter. Another husband is a pushover and his wife wears the pants in the family. Still another man is even killed, thoughtful and deliberate. All of these are different portraits of husbands and households. Husbands who lead or don't lead or don't realize they're leading, but they're leading somewhere. And they're leading their wives in different ways for different reasons. And for most of these husbands, though not all of them, really the day comes and they just wing it. They do what's right in their own eyes. And the thing is that these men, you could go interview them and interview them about their fathers. And you can see patterns and examples. Some of these men were examples of not doing what their dad did, and so they're course correcting a different direction. Some of them didn't want to do what their dad did, but they're really just turning into another version of their father. Some of them had an absent father and are just trying to wing it because they're trying to figure it out. Such is the state of many men and husbands in our world. But as you heard me pray, there's a question before us. What does God want? God does not leave us and us men blind or ignorant in what he wants in a godly husband. So today in 1 Peter 3:7, God is going to call us. He is going to call us to be godly husbands. And in calling us to be godly husbands, God is also going to give us what we need to do that. Gospel hope, the power of his Spirit, that we can, by God's grace, be godly husbands. And by his power, we can course correct as we need. Today in 1 Peter 3:7, we are going to be given a word of hope. Hope for struggling marriages, wayward marriages, confused marriages. Hope especially for husbands. And today you might be here this morning and you might not yet be a follower of Jesus Christ. What we want you to know together more than anything is that Jesus' death for our sins and his resurrection from the grave, they rescue us from God's wrath against us. What Jesus does in his life and death is he rescues us, he delivers us from sin, he delivers us from our own errors, and then he empowers us to live new lives. So you might be here not knowing Jesus, and you've only known train wrecks of relationships. What we want you to know is the most important relationship that needs to get fixed is yours with God. And you can't fix it, but he does through Jesus. And when you come to Jesus and find a relationship fixed by Jesus with God, then your earthly relationships can be fixed. So I don't want you to walk away this morning with tips and techniques of how to be a better husband or look for a future husband, but really how to know Christ. But with all that said, the outline this morning comes to us with three questions, as has been our pattern in this particular series. Here they are. Question number one, what authority has Jesus assigned to a husband? What authority has a Jesus assigned to a husband? Next, in what ways does Jesus want a husband to dwell with his wife? First, what authority has Jesus assigned to a husband? Next, in what ways does Jesus want a husband to live with his wife? And last, what is at stake if a husband misuses his authority? What is at stake if a husband misuses his authority? And kids, I saw you grabbing your notes today, and so you can see those are the three words I want you to listen for: authority, and dwell, and prayer. Well, let's jump right into the word this morning. Our first question is, what authority has Jesus assigned to a husband? Let's look again at our verse, verse 7. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. We have taken time in this series to step back and zoom out from the book of 1 Peter and think more broadly about what the Bible says regarding authority and submission. And so the question here is, what authority has Jesus assigned to a husband? We need to deal with that first. It's in the background of the text, but it's not explicit in the text. It's something that we have talked about in weeks past, but I want to remind us, because authority is important. And we live in a world where authority is misused. And it always serves us to remember that only Jesus Christ and Him alone, because He died and rose and ascended and is seated on His throne, only Jesus, Matthew 28:18, has all authority in heaven on earth. There is no adjacent authority next to Him. There's no other authority that rivals Him. Any human authority exists gets their authority from Jesus. So every husband in this room, every future husband in this room, the authority that we have as husbands is not innate in us. It's not because we are male or anything about us. It's because Jesus delegates authority to us as a stewardship that we use in marriage, which means that we are accountable to Christ for how we use authority. Every husband needs to know that. That's true of every non-Christian husband as well. Every husband will give an account to Christ for his husbanding of his wife. What we see in our text, when verse 7 begins with likewise husbands, we could go to Colossians, we could go to Ephesians, we can go to other family texts in the Bible, and what the Bible is clear about all the time, a husband does not submit to his wife. We saw back up in verse 1, the wife subjects herself to the husband, but the husband, he is the head. He has the responsibility to lead. And we've seen that week in and week out. But a husband, let me tell you what authority he does not have. A husband does not have authority or permission from God to lead his wife into sin. And Jesus does not require a wife to submit to sin. A husband does not have authority from Jesus to forbid what God commands. And a husband does not have authority from Jesus to command what God forbids. Forbid what God commands, command what God forbids. A husband does not have authority from Christ to do that. So what authority does a husband have? A recently published book that is extremely helpful, it's actually called Authority. It's by Jonathan Lehman. And in it, he surveys different authority structures. And he describes a husband's authority as an authority of counsel, not command. And what he means by that is that Jesus does not give a husband an enforcement mechanism in the relationship with his wife. Think about that. A husband is to lead by example. He is to lead by appeals. He is to lead with counsel, with the word of God, and he's to lead with prayer. But the Bible never puts the parental rod of discipline for children in the hands of a husband for his wife. The Bible does not put the sword of the state in the hands of a husband against his wife. The Bible never puts the keys of the kingdom that belong to the church into the hands of a husband to excommunicate his wife. He is not authorized. It is an abuse and misuse of authority if there's a rod or a sword or the keys. A husband does not hold those in marriage with his wife. If need be, a husband can appeal to the state. If she is doing things that are illegal, he can appeal to the state and call the police to step in. If she claims to be a Christian, if they attend church, he can appeal to the church to exercise the keys of the kingdom with a rebellious wife and enter the steps of church discipline, maybe even excommunicating her if need be. But again, the Bible, Jesus, never puts an enforcement mechanism or tool into the hands of a husband to coerce his wife, to threaten his wife, to force his wife, to manipulate his wife, to withhold things from his wife, to do anything to force his wife to do anything. A husband is not authorized to do that. And if you do, you're in sin. Rather, a husband prays. He models Jesus. He goes to God's word, mines its resources, and then he brings those gospel truths to bear on their relationship. And then the husband prays more, and he waits. And the husband recognizes that the wife, in her role as a wife, that she is as accountable to God as he is, him for his use of authority, her for her use of submission. She's accountable to the Lord for her submission and obedience to him. And notice how Peter grounds his admonition to husbands in our text. He grounds. This is why a husband lives with his wife in an understanding way. It says there towards the end, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life. Why is Peter calling a husband to live in an understanding manner? How is a husband to use his authority? Well, first, it's in view that she is a co-heir of the grace of life. The reason a husband lives with his wife, loves his wife, treats his wife, talks with his wife, is that she is an equal image bearer of God. Neither the man nor the woman is more or less the image of God than the other, but even more, brothers, listen to me, even more, your wife, she is a fellow Christian. She is a blood-bought saint. Jesus lived, died, he hung on that cross, he rose with your wife in view, with her name on his lips, as it were, to save her. She is a fellow Christian, and brothers, your wife is God's daughter. Don't upset your father-in-law. She is not more or less a gospel woman than you are a gospel man. There is a stewardship in the authority that we are given. And more than that, as God's daughter, the one who's called to submit and obey you, she has a special place in her father's heart. What do I mean? What I mean is about the special place that she has, I'm actually distinguishing a place that your wife has with God the Father that you don't have. What do I mean? If you go and you read Isaiah to Malachi, read the prophets, over and over and over again, we see that God has a unique disposition and eye that focuses on the vulnerable, right? He is greatly concerned, also go to the book of James, for widows, young and old, for orphans, for those who are in positions of submission, and when the authority over them is a tyrant, God has a unique care for those who are in those difficult situations. That's what I mean by God the Father having a unique, special place for your wife in Him. Husbands, your wife is a co-heir of eternal life, of gospel grace. She remains God's daughter. You are a steward of her, entrusted by Jesus with authority to make her better. We're going to see a little bit later in the next point, your task is actually to beautify her. But do you know how you beautify her? With the Word of God. You are a steward. You're accountable to God. You are to provide for her, protect her, bless her. You are to honor her as a co-heir of eternal life. In fact, look again at our text. What does it say? Our text says, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel. Honor. Honor. You are to show men honor. You're to demonstrate honor. You're to display honor to your wife. Your wife is to know that she is valued, prized, appreciated, desired, revered. There should be no doubt in your wife's mind that you honor her. It's like that old saying where, you know, you never say that you love me. Yes, I did. I said it at the altar when we got married. And then he never says it again. No, brothers. Assume every day she forgets that you love her, and assume every day that she has forgotten that you honor her, and spend your day making sure that your wife knows that she is the most loved, revered, and honored woman on the face of the earth. Should there be a happier wife on the face of the earth than your own? That word honor in the Greek means to value. It means to prize, to treasure, to revere, to respect. Guys, we like stuff. We have our gadgets. We have our gear. You've got your rifles. You've got your cars. You've got your technology. You have all the trinkets and all the things that we like. We revere them. But there is that sad tendency in us that we've got the girl. We got married. You get used to the relationship. And then she kind of can feel like a second-class citizen in the marriage, where everyone or everything takes more precedence over her. What does Peter tell you? Show honor to the woman. And that word woman, it's interesting that he says, he doesn't say wife there, he says woman. And the idea is a feminine one. Feminine one. To honor means that you respect her. It comes to mind, Proverbs 31:10. Who can find a wife of noble character? She is far more precious than rubies. The Bible's talking to you guys. Your wife is your standard of preciousness. She is your jewel. She is your prized possession, as it were. What does it look like to honor the wife? Well, the Proverbs 31 husband shows us. We saw him last week. Let's see him again. Proverbs 31, 28 and 29. It says that when she enters the room, they're about to sit down to have a meal, her children rise up, call mom blessed, her husband also. He stands up and he takes his hat off, opens the door for her. Her husband also stands up, calls her blessed, and then he praises her, saying this, many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. The gift of your wife, she is your standard and your example of Proverbs 31. And she needs to know that, brothers. No doubt, no mistake. Labor hard. If you need to set a reminder, hey Siri, remind me to tell my wife that she's a smoke show and hot. Whatever you need to do,
Let her know that she is that Proverbs 31 woman. Proverbs, that's how, brothers, your holy father, your father, wants you to talk, treat, think, view your beloved and cherished wife. And then we have those words there where the Bible calls her the weaker vessel. See, brothers, remember the overarching question. This is how you use your authority for life-giving good. That's what I'm trying to drive at here, life-giving good. What does weaker vessel mean? Here's what it does not mean. Weaker vessel, calling a woman a weaker vessel, does not mean that she is inferior intellectually. Doesn't mean that she has less wisdom than you. She might be wiser than you. She might be more intellectual than you. And that's a gift. To be a weaker vessel does not mean that she is inferior to you spiritually. She might be a better theologian than you. It does not mean that she is somehow less moral than you. There is debate among commentators if this is referring to emotions. Maybe. I think it's doubtful. Why do I say that? Because men can also be driven out of control by emotions as well. Have you heard of lust and anger? To be sure, women do have a different gifted emotional state than men. It's just not immediately clear from the text that what Peter has in mind, he's thinking about emotions when he says weaker vessel. No, the natural reading is physical stature. That word vessel is a play on words. It's a euphemism. It means jar. It's also used of men in the book of Acts and in the book of Romans. It's just a reference to your body. And so the natural reading of weaker vessel is weaker body. Is that debatable? Now, in our culture, it is, since men can pretend to be women and do sports, which they ought not to do. But a weaker vessel, the implication here is that in her stature, she is smaller than you. She has a smaller frame. Or conversely, brothers, you have built-in strength, your morphology of your physiology, your musculature, having twice as much or more musculature on your upper body than her, etc. That's what it means. It's physicality. In his commentary, Wayne Grudem actually adds a few wise perspectives that further explain this idea of weaker vessel. He says that it can also carry a sense of her position relative to authority, meaning she's a person in submission. And because she has to submit, there is a weakness in the sense that she doesn't have the authority to authorize things. She is required to obey and submit. So in that sense, there's a weakness where she's responsible to obey. I think that that's pretty persuasive. But certainly he has in view this idea of strength. But here's why. You know what's implied in this? Is that a husband, remember, think back a few weeks when we talked about how the fall has affected marriage, Genesis 3, and that a husband is prone to either being passive or domineering. The violence that can be inherent in a male, the anger, is that we can use our strength for violence to overpower a woman. In other words, here when Peter is writing these words, he is completely cutting the throat of any notion of a man using physical violence against a woman. It's implied in it. It begs a question then. Husbands, if your wife is the weaker vessel, Jesus requires her to submit to you, and she is smaller than you, generally speaking, it begs the question, brothers, what is it like to submit to you? What is it like to be under your use of authority in the home? For your wife, is your use of authority life-giving and gospel flourishing or not? If you had to submit to you, what would you think? It's a hard question. And wrapped in all of this is that we as brothers, we as men, we as husbands are to use our position in life-giving ways, using strength not to overpower, not to overbear, not to hurt, but to give life, to protect, to love, to care, all being aware of God designing her with a greater emotional sensitivity, which then does go back to also this notion of a weaker vessel, of how we men use our words or don't use our words, often affect her in ways that don't affect us with that emotional sensitivity. So again, in asking this question and all of this, what authority has Jesus assigned to a husband? A man or husband cannot force, cannot coerce a wife into anything. It is forbidden. It is a unique type of sin before God in which he has special vengeance against a man who does these things. Because men, we have seen week in and week out that the role that we are assigned is the role of Christ, being like Jesus. So when we misuse authority, we are being unlike Jesus. And in those moments with our words, our lack of words, our demeanor, our tone, our expression, our physicality, we are preaching a false gospel by misrepresenting Jesus, who is gentle and lowly. So brothers, do not scare her, coerce her through physical force or violence. Don't push her. Don't punish her around with your words. Don't do anything. Don't give a silent treatment. Don't withhold a love against her because you feel disrespected by her. She is responsible to Jesus for how she treats you. You're responsible to Jesus about how you treat her, but her sin against you never gives you permission to sin against her. Instead, show honor to your wife. Care for her, love her, live with her as a prized treasure. But the question is, how? How do we do that? And that leads to the second set of questions. In what ways does Jesus want a husband to live or dwell with his wife? Look again at the beginning of our verse. Likewise, husbands, and here it is, live with your wives in an understanding way. What does it mean to live with your wife in an understanding manner? The Greek text literally says, live according to knowledge. And then it doesn't say wives. Our translators insert, wives are implied, but they insert that into the text. What's going on here? So on the face in our Bible, it sounds like that my task as a husband is to know my wife, understand her, and then live with her according to that. To know the uniqueness of your wife. But in his commentary, Tom Schreiner makes a very persuasive case that the text, the referent here is not knowing your wife, live with knowledge of your wife. He argues it's live with knowledge of God. Because again, remember what I said in the Greek? The Greek says simply live with knowledge. Live with knowledge. What does that mean? What does it imply? It implies this, that you could translate the text this way. Here's the essence of it. Husbands, live with knowledge, knowing what God wants of you as a husband towards your wife. So in other words, know what God wants for you, know what God wants for her, know what God wants for both of you, and then now lead your marriage that way. But I think in the end, both ideas are true. But it could be lost in our translation. In other words, the translation that we have before us can make it sound like you need to be a student of your wife, but not a student of God. Be a student of God first to know what he wants so that you can live with your wife in an understanding manner. If you don't understand God, you can't understand your wife in living with her in an understanding manner. So I see both are in view. A husband then is to first and foremost know what God wants for the husband. Then the wife, then the marriage. After all, a wife could want things in the marriage and from her husband that are contrary to his word. Your wife could be asking things of you, requiring things of you, as it were, that Jesus does not ask of you or require of you. And husbands, you need to know that so that you can lead properly. Or conversely, she could be asking you to do things for her that Jesus wants you to do that you're not doing. And so you need to go to the word, know those things so that you can do them. In other words, a husband must be able to discern what God wants so that you can understand your wife and lead her well. A husband is to know what God wants him to be. A husband is to know what God wants a wife to be. And then with that knowledge, a husband is to lead and direct the affairs of his household in Christ. Guys, be Bible guys. Know your Bibles. If you're cut, bleed Bible. Know the word well, and then be Bible guys as the best you can so that you can know how to navigate your marriage, because this is the lamp to your path. Another way to say this is that both spouses are to know what God wants and then help each other become what God wants, not what they want. Right, ladies, your guy is not a fixer-upper for you. He's a fixer-upper for the Holy Spirit. And by the way, you're a fixer-upper too for the Holy Spirit. And the Lord does use us as instruments for each other's good to fix us up, meaning to be more like Jesus. But we have to know what God wants. So with that, what are some ways a husband can dwell with his wife, knowing both God and her? I'm going to give you, how many am I going to give you? I'm going to give you three. Because what we have in the text is a principle. Here's the principle. And brothers, your task is to spend the rest of your life figuring out how to apply that to your unique marriage. But here are some additional principles. How can you dwell in a knowing way? Number one, brothers, know what Jesus wants you to be for her. You need to know what Jesus wants you to be for her. Now, we could turn to Ephesians 5. We'll actually turn there in a few moments. But what does that mean? What does Jesus want from you? Let me just summarize, because we could go to, well, the whole Bible. But Jesus wants you to fear God, to know the Word of God, to keep God's Word, to be a godly man that models Christ's love for the church. Ephesians 5 tells husbands, it tells us to give ourselves up for our wives. That means the exercise of our authority is to daily die to ourselves, carry our cross, and then die so that we can give our life, our wife life. It's a metaphor. Only Jesus saves. We don't save. But the idea is that I don't wake up to live self-centered ways, but in one sense, gospel-centered ways for God, which includes blessing my wife. And brothers, you've got to know God's word. You have to. You know what we're like. Whether it's hunting, whether it's your sports team, whether it's politics, whatever you're interested in, you are a functional PhD in. You are an expert in that. Health and fitness, whatever your deal is. And the thing is, with the same fervor that we pursue our hobbies and interests, brothers, we must discipline ourselves to pursue first and foremost knowing God in Christ. And it's in the book. It's in the book. Know what Jesus wants you to be for her. She wants you to be godly, and Jesus wants you to be godly. Jesus wants you to protect her. You know what that means? Jesus wants you to protect her from you. Because remember, you bring your sin into the marriage. So you need to protect your wife from your sin. You need to prayerfully protect your wife from her sin. You need to prayerfully protect your wife from other people's sin and from evil and from harm. That physicality, strength, and size the Lord has given you is to include protecting her from sin and evil, beginning with your own. That's why I often tell young men, or any guy who enters into a dating relationship, here's my dating advice. Every time you're together, put her hand in Jesus' hand and protect her from yourself. Really good dating advice. I didn't make it up. That's why it's really good dating advice. But not only does Jesus want you to be godly and be a protector, he wants you to be a provider. To the best of your ability, give her food, shelter, clothing, security, but not just the stuff. Give her yourself, friendship, companionship. Give her your presence. And what does Jesus want you to be for her with authority? Take the lead. Take the lead spiritually. What might that look like? That might look like this. Before you go to bed, you pray for you both of you. Just pray for each other. You might feel embarrassed. You might stumble over your words. That's okay, brothers. It's okay. Pray for her. Let her hear you pray for her. Let her hear you pray for the kids, and let her pray together, and ideally pray together out loud. Make decisions. Bring her to church as often as possible. After she listens to the message, ask her what helped her most from the Word of God that morning. What was she thinking about? Ask her, in what ways do you think the Lord wants you to apply the sermon to your life? Brothers, how do you dwell with your wife in an understanding manner? Lead her in these ways. But next, number two, knowing what Jesus wants you to be for her. Next, know who she uniquely is. Know who she uniquely is and what Jesus wants her to be. Know your wife's conscience. What is right and wrong for her? Know your wife's hopes. What does she want for you? What does she want for her? What does she want for family and life? And as we saw back up in verse 6, where she's not supposed to fear anything that is frightening, know her fears. Where is she tempted to anxiety? Where is she tempted to depression? Where is she tempted to doubt? Know her fears. Know her desires. What does she like? What brings her happiness and joy? Brothers, know her besetting sins. What are her struggles and temptations? Know her insecurities. Where does the fallenness of this world, her remaining sin, cause her to feel less than? Where does she feel not enough? Where does she feel not pretty? Know these things about her. Know her insecurities. And then, brothers, armed with all of that information, you pray for her. You speak God's word to her with encouragement and gentleness. When you see her fears, when you see her sins, when you see her insecurities, you have gone to the word, and then you seek to apply the word to her life, and you pray for her. Ephesians 5 paints this beautiful picture. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Why did Jesus do that? Verse 26, so that he might sanctify her, make her more holy. How? Having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. So brothers, Jesus died to redeem the church, and in a parable-like fashion, we died to ourselves, and then with the word of God bringing to bear on our wives, it cleanses her, as it were. It makes her more holy. But what's the net effect of that? Verse 27 says this, so that. So Jesus dies, purifies the church. Why did Jesus do that? So that Jesus might present the church to himself. Do you see the logic? Brothers, you die to yourself, not selfish. Be other-oriented. Bring the word of God to bear in your marriage. It beautifies your wife, makes her more like Jesus, and then in her being beautified and being more like Jesus, you present her to yourself, and it serves you because of her splendor. So your wife's splendor is tied to how you use authority and dwell with her in an understanding manner. By the way, there's application in that, young brothers who desire to marry in your singleness, not to take from your girlfriend who is not from your wife anything that is not yours until you say, I do, and put a ring on her finger. At the altar. The more that you take from your wife, who is not your wife, rather, but your girlfriend, before you're married, is a spoiling affair, not a splendorous affair. You must be pure in your dating relationship, And the more pure you're in your relationship, the logic of Ephesians 5 is that when you present her to yourself, she is that more beautified because you have guarded her heart and soul and your own, and you have served to put each other's hands in Jesus' hands. Self-sacrifice, brothers. Self-sacrifice, which serves your wife or future wife, beautifies her, and ultimately it's in your best interest. Ephesians 5. And then finally, number three. So what is, how do you dwell in an understanding way? Know what Jesus wants for you to be. Number two, know who she uniquely is on a practical level and what Jesus wants her to be. And then three, and this is brief, know your shared intimacy together. I want to be discreet here. Intimacy in marriage is about being other-oriented. It's other-oriented service. Intimacy in marriage, whatever kind there is not primarily for you. It's your service to your spouse. It's a gift. It's you meeting their needs and fulfilling their desires. So husbands, translation, that means that you are serving your wife's needs and your wife's desires over your own and before your own. From date nights to the bedroom, 1 Corinthians 7 says that a husband does not have authority over his own body. His wife does, and vice versa. A verse worth pondering. This has many implications we're not going to go into now, but for now I want to say, husbands, serve your wives. Talk to her about what would serve her in every area of intimacy in your life. And then ask God to give you the strength and the wisdom and the ability to bless and serve your wife. Finally, final point, what then is at stake when a husband misuses his authority? Look at the end of our verse. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding manner, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that. We're about to find out what's at stake, brothers, if we don't do this. So that your prayers may not be hindered. Brothers, do you see those words in your Bible? They should make you afraid, because they make me afraid. What is at stake if you misuse your authority? What's at stake if you don't live with your wife in an understanding way? What's at stake if you don't show honor to your wife as the weaker vessel? What's at stake if you misuse your strength against her? What's at stake if you don't realize she's a co-heir of the grace of life with you? Your prayers. And this does not mean that it's because you guys are having strife in your marriage, you're not going to pray together, though that's what happens. This means that God, in some way, uniquely, will not listen to your prayers. Next to not being saved, that's the worst thing you could hear. A God who puts the close sign on those prayers that are supposed to be like incense going up to his throne. He does not want us as husbands to be hypocrites. How fearful and sobering a statement can there be? Brothers, if you do not treat God's daughter as he wants, if you do not honor the woman for whom Christ shed his blood, if you do not value your Christian wife in whom the Holy Spirit dwells, then your prayers will be hindered. Means that when you talk to God, you can't expect or assume that he's going to listen to you because of the way that you treat your wife. In a very real sense, the only prayer God hears for a man who is a tyrant in his home is a prayer of repentance. And he won't listen to any other prayer from you until you repent of those sins and live with your wife in an understanding manner and be the husband that he wants you to be. But brothers, let me say something to you with who do fear the Lord and do have a sensitive conscience. This text is focusing on the husband who characteristically misuses his authority, and he's a hard-hearted husband. This is not threatening a Jesus-loving, trying his best, humble husband such that you have to fret whether God closes his ears to you every day. This is talking to the guy who doesn't care or is indifferent to what God thinks. But when you and we, brothers, care what God thinks and want to be this for our beloved wives, know that God does hear our prayers. But nonetheless, this text is here. And it serves as that warning, that don't cross the line sign, so that we would be motivated to love our wives as Christ loved the church. Husbands, it may very well be that you are not who or what or where you want to be. Your wife, not who you think she should be. Your kids, setbacks, and more. But brothers, this is a hard sermon, but it's a sacred task. It's a sacred task. We have a sacred stewardship. We have a sacred authority from Jesus for our beloved brides. Brothers, don't misuse it, and don't miss it. This is part of redeeming the time. Because if you're not using Jesus' authority for Jesus, you're using your authority for yourself. And that's tyranny. And there very well may be a connection down in verse 12. This is also scary. 1 Peter 3:12. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. His ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. We do not want God's face against us. We want his eyes on us because we have Jesus' righteousness. Why is this so serious? Because the gospel is at stake. Week in, week out, we've seen that husband is in the role of Christ. Wife is in the role of the church. Our marriage together preaches a gospel, especially to our little ones in our homes, but to all who have eyes to see. And if I or you misuse your husbanding, if wives misuse their wifing, we change the gospel, as it were, and preach a false gospel. A bad husband preaches a false Jesus. A good husband preaches a true Jesus. And so, brothers, with sobriety, let us wake up to the sacred task we've been given and pursue our wives in the name of Christ. And brothers, listen, God is always happy to bestow grace. If you hear this and you only hear condemnation, you're not hearing the gospel. God is ever ready and present. Jesus has a throne that we boldly approach in the time of need. And brothers, there is moment by moment need for everything we're called to do as men in this world. But as husbands, we can repent. We can model Christ. We can go to his throne and receive grace. We can receive his blessings. We can be reminded that he has washed away all of our bad husband sins. And we can bow the knees once again to King Jesus and receive that strength from him. And you know what? I believe your wives will be pleased. So sisters, pray for us that we will be this for you. Brothers, let us by God's grace humble ourselves to be these kind of men of God. Amen. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We ask you to pour it out upon us. We love you and pray this in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen. Friends, I want you to stand.